bring it back. From the Groove Remains production team studios in the Netherlands. My name is Mixmaster G and welcome to this live stream. My mission is not to sell you as many apps as I can. No, my mission is to educate and teach you about audio track collection management and conversion for DJs, so you save yourself more time for the fun and creative part of being a DJ. It is midsummer in the Netherlands and we are in for our fourth heat wave this year. So global warming is a thing, apparently. Last week there was not an Ask Me Anything stream because I was busy with some other things, and during summer you can expect that, but I try to be here each and every week for you guys to ask questions and to answer questions that I gathered over the past week. First of all, AG Flow, welcome to the stream, my friend, good to see you. And Adrian, good to see you too. And of course you can ask questions, that is why I do this stream. So by all means, just drop it in the chat and I can see what I can do with those questions. What I did last week was, however, the workflow stream. The workflow stream is a stream that I do ever so often, and I use that to test my apps. Usually I do it at the end of a beta period. And I show you how I intend my apps to be used. If you haven't watched it, watch it. I explain a lot of stuff about collection management in general there. So if you are thinking about streamlining your own workflow when you download or buy new tracks, what to do with them, how to do it. What's that workflow? It might have some inspiration for you, some pointers for you. I'm not claiming to have the most perfect workflow ever, because a workflow is very personal. However, I think I do a lot of things that are pretty smart or at least useful for other DJs. So that's why I do those workflow videos. Take your advantage from it. That's why I'm doing this kind of stuff. But let me introduce myself. My name is Mix Master G. I am a 55-year-old dude from the Netherlands. I had my first DJ residency at the age of 15, which means this is almost 40 years of DJ experience in the flesh. I am no longer an active DJ. I call myself a retired DJ, but I say that with the highest regard. It's just that I'm not doing weekly gigs anymore. I do a gig ever so often. However, I spend my days with this kind of stuff. I make apps for DJs. I am most famous for the DJ Conversion Utility, which converts cues, loops, playlists, etc. between various DJ software. But there are much more tools besides the DJ Conversion Utility. So by all means, have a look at those and see what they can do for you. Each Tuesday at 7 o'clock p.m. Central European Time, I host this Ask Me Anything stream, where you can ask me any kind of questions that are subject related. Sometimes we do a special about a certain subject. Today is kind of going to be a Serato special. I feel that a Serato special is coming up. Why, you will see in a moment, but I had a couple of questions about Serato coming in, and there are some things on the Serato front going on as well. I see that Adrian dropped his question as well. Let's see, Adrian. I will have a look at your question later on, because that is a lot of text, my friend, but I think I can help you. So hold on there. Because first we are going over the news, over the things that, actually were happening in the past week in the world of DJing, and things that are actually happening right now. Because right now it is DJ Expo 2022 in Atlantic City. And I had even... not too long, Adrian, not too long, just a long one. Let me first open the website about it. Then you all know what I'm talking about. This is the website about it. And you can see it costs rather a lot of money to enter it, to access it. Now, I was looking to find a map of the show floor, because this expo is basically partly trade show, partly panels, workshops, etc., etc. I had been thinking about going to that show, but the economics of it didn't add up. If you make apps that are $20 for a lifetime license, then you understand that in order to make right for these kind of events, you have to sell a lot of them. But I was amazed it isn't that big anymore. It used to be the biggest event in America, DJ related. I think NEM already took over that, though DJing is just a small part of NEM. I think it is still bigger in total size than the DJ Expo in Atlantic City. But there are some people there who do panels, and in general, you go there just to connect and to talk to the people. Now, what I can recommend is keep your eyes open on Twitch. I know that my man Mike Marquez is going to do a live stream from the show floor tomorrow. I think that Kova Twig Music Tips is also going to do a walk around on the show floor, and that gives you an impression how big or how small it is. I have been looking to find a map of the floor, of the show floor, but all I could find was this. Let me put that in full screen mode, like this. There are no names in it, and it even says it is not final, and it was from the DJ Expo floor. But you can see there are not that many booths. Names that are notoriously missing from the DJ Expo 2022 are, for instance, In Music. That is the brand that has Denon, Numark, and Rain. They don't have a booth. Hercules is missing. Electro Voice is missing. Some really big names in the DJ world are missing. And to my feeling, trade shows are kind of becoming a thing of the past, with reviews from guys like Mojax and Cleveland Terry, etc., doing reviews for gear online. You don't have to go to the trade show anymore to put your hands on the gear. You can just watch the reviews and you know pretty much what they will do. And with things like Amazon, etc., gives you a 40-day time window to return goods that you don't like. You basically are your own reviewer. You just order it and you send it back. And I know that a lot of DJs are doing that. I'm not condoning it. I'm neutral on that. But hey, it is the way the world works these days. So that is something to keep in mind. The show is small, is as small as it was last year. And last year we were in the middle of a pandemic. But it's still a great opportunity to network and to meet friends. I cannot say much more about it. DJ Expo is going on right now. What did amaze me though, and that's something that is weird in America for someone from Europe. Here in Europe, COVID is close to death. Nobody talks about COVID, etc. Then 3 weeks ago, we had the Comic-Con in San Diego. And that is like a huge event for nerds like me who like American pop culture. And at Comic-Con San Diego, face masks were mandatory for all visitors. I think that's a good thing then, because hey, you better be safe than sorry. DJ Expo, no such thing. It's handshaking, close contact, etc., the whole thing. So not really the thing I would like to do. All right, let's talk shop. Let's talk about what is going on in the world of DJ software and hardware and technology. Let me switch cams. By the way, I am notorious for forgetting to switch my cam. So if you see that happen, that I forget to switch my cam, please scream it in the chat box that I forgot to switch my cam, because otherwise I think that you can see what I'm talking about, while in truth you are just looking at my face and nothing else. DJ on the ones and twos, good to have you with me, buddy. Good to see you. Ogrims DJ did just release an update, and that was a kind of two-in-one update, because it says 4.05. However, it says here 4.04 and then 4.05 near the bottom. Apparently, there were some problems with the Rev7 connection with Algorithms DJ on iOS, and they fixed that. As some of you might recall, I went to the store immediately when DJ announced that they were Rev7 compatible to test it out, and I had a little bit of problems with it myself. So that seems to be fixed. Overall, new update, solid update. Download the update, because otherwise you might be left alone. Then the other thing we need to talk about is this one, namely our friends from Serato did an update. The update is Serato 2.6, and there are some important things about this update that are easy to overlook. First of all, silent cues are now a feature and MIDI mappable in the MIDI panel. For those of you who play DVS, silent cues might be something that you really might enjoy using. I'm not a big silent cue fan. I know my friend Mojax is, however, and others. So hey, if that's a thing for you, it is there. But what struck my eyes about this update is that it can now be installed on macOS 10.14 Monterey. That macOS was released almost a year ago. So finally, Serato greenlights their users to go to Monterey. Now, I understand that, especially with the M1 machines, driver compatibility is an issue, and drivers working on those machines is an issue. But hey guys, please, a year after the official macOS release, we are awaiting macOS Ventura, which will be updated, I think, in the coming weeks. And the question is, how compatible will it then be? So we have to wait for that and what Serato is going to say about that. But I'm surprised that they didn't dare to put there, listen, it is compatible with the macOS Ventura developers release, and we think we are okay with the final release, which would be the status quo at this moment. But no, they particularly said Monterey is fine, everything else, we're not sure. So keep that in mind. Another thing that is also important is that, oh, I was doing the wrong thing, because this is the important thing. In the past, Serato was the lowest macOS version you could run Serato on was High Sierra 10.13. Right now, no longer the case, 10.14, which is Mojave, is the latest version that you need to run Yeah, it's indeed Eddie Brome. You are correct. It is actually the minimum. 10.14 is the minimum, and Monterey is the current one that they blessed. I don't know. It should be somewhere here, but at least Monterey is the one they blessed. And 10.14 is the minimum. That is Mojave. Keep that in mind, because I know a lot of guys that are still on High Sierra, and they cannot update. So if you want those features, you need to update your Mac to at least macOS Monterey. Of course, I have been playing with it a little bit. As some of you might know, I have two CDJ 3000s in front of me, together with, let me get it on. Oh, hold on, I need to remap that like this. There we are. CDJ 3000 and a DGM 900 Nexus 2, which are supported by Serato out of the box. Now, let me show you something which is a little bit annoying about Serato, but some are getting this. Each time I start up my Serato, I get this message that I need to update my driver. So, okay, I update my driver. Let's install the driver, shall we? Then we come to this. By the way, this is a Pioneer installer, because it's Pioneer gear, and Serato just alerts me that we need to install that from Pioneer. So let's press continue. Let's accept the thing and agree with it. And then you can see it needs 10.15 as the minimum OS. Now, I understand that this is becoming kind of a mess, but please, 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 if you know that the running OS is not high enough to update, take the update message away, because it is annoying as hell, and I fall for it each time that I see that message. All right, let's update it, and then it can't be updated. Something to keep in mind. Another thing to keep in mind, and that is related to the algorithm DJ update, you need to be at least on Mojave 14.6. The DVS system behind me was on 14.3 and refused to update to DJ Pro AI. I needed to be on 14.6, and once I updated to 14.6, everything was fine. Another thing that I found out this week while playing a little bit with it is that the Traktor Control Final is not compatible with Algorithm. It will not calibrate on the Traktor Control Final. So Algorithm is kind enough to send me a set of their Control Final. So I have to wait a little bit for that longer in order to test that out and to see what that can do. So that was all about updates, updates, updates galore. Now, before I move into the sent message, or the stuff that was sent in as questions, let me go to the questions that are asked here. Adrian has a very long story. Let's see what I use Serato and also then an SCC 5000 DeX. I can plug my external hard drive into either Serato or Denon, and my files, playlists, etc. all show up. I'm trying to get my hard drive Pioneer ready, as I'm playing out using Pioneer DeX more often, and then it stops. But I think where we are, I think I understand where we are going here. I have, let's see, I have 1,000 of crates with Serato and Denon, have no problem displaying, but Pioneer will only let me browse by folder and file name. I believe I have to export all the music via Rekordbox to another hard drive. The problem is Rekordbox informs me there is a 1,000 playlist limit. How can I bypass this limitation? Hope this question is clear. Adrian, you are, first of all, you are mixing up some things here. In the Rekordbox ecosystem, we have something called the performance drive, and we have something called the drive for Rekordbox. Those two are different entities. You cannot connect a Rekordbox drive to a CDJ and use it the way you can, for instance, with Denon, and the way you can with Serato. Reason for that is, in layman's terms, Rekordbox and the Pioneer ecosystem store everything in a central database, and Engine DJ and Serato both are what they call distributed databases, which means that the drive that contains the tracks also contains that part of the database with the information. So that means that whenever you want to prepare for CDJ usage, you first need to have your tracks in Rekordbox, and then you can prepare a CDGA from Rekordbox. Now, in order to get crates and stuff into Rekordbox, you need conversion software. EngineDJ and EngineOS can read Serato crates to a certain extent. However, if you want to go from Serato to Rekordbox, you need my software. You need the DJ conversion utility to convert your Serato crates to Rekordbox playlists. The limitation you are talking about is a limitation of tracks in a playlist. There is no longer with Rekordbox 6 a playlist limitation. It can have as many playlists as you like. It might be possible that when you export to a CDJ USB that you have limitations, but trust me, you don't want to export 1,000 playlists to a CDJ USB because first of all, it will take close to forever to sync up. And second of all, if you have ever tried to navigate on a CDJ display, you don't want to have a lot of tracks and a lot of playlists there. If you have a CDJ 3000 in front of you, like I have, that works close to what you're used to in SC5000. But if you have a CDJ 2000 Nexus 2, those are really a drama to navigate, to find the track. So please, keep that in mind. You need to go from Serato to Rekordbox, create a USB specifically for CDJs, and that will all work. There are tutorials in my YouTube channel about all of this. If you just go to my YouTube channel and you go to the Serato playlist, you find the first tutorial will most likely be how to convert from Serato to Rekordbox. And there is a tutorial, an old, but it is one of the best watched tutorials in my channel about how you create a CDJ USB. And there are some tips if you are on CDJ USBs for the first time. So keep that in mind. That is basically, I hope that answer is clear. If not, just ask me what is not clear and I'm happy to help you with it. Sapfap, great to see you, my friend. Good to have you in the stream and welcome. And people are usually very respectful in my chat, but thank you for that. I have a very nice crowd around me. I really enjoy that. DJ on the ones and twos, question. I get a few audio dropouts when my Rain 12s MK2 are connected to Pioneer S11 mixer, but I don't have that issue with Technics 1200s are connected. The USB cable and gear are 1 year old. That sounds to me, DJ on the ones and two, like it's still a USB bandwidth problem. If you use Rain 12s, then you still use a bit of USB bandwidth in order to send the control signal through. If you use the S11 with DVS on Technics, then you basically have one USB line that has all the information. That is the one to the S11. My advice would be to double check that first of all you are on a USB 3 bus, that your hub is USB 3, or just take a USB 3 powered hub and see if that improves the situation. This has the feeling of a USB issue because the S11 needs a lot of bandwidth from in order to work with it, because it got four channel or two channels in four tracks. It needs to display all the Serato information. So there's a lot of data going over that USB cable already. And then if there are, in addition to that, if there is information from the control vinyl or from the 12s, then I can imagine that the bandwidth in the USB cable can be a struggle. So that is something worth trying. Other thing, keep your USB cables as short as possible, because the longer the cable, the more interference and noise can get on the cable, and that can also distort and create dropouts and the like. So I think it is a cable issue. It has the hallmarks of a cable issue, especially because you tell me the moment I use my Technics 12s, and that means that everything is going into the audio card of the S11, and everything comes out on one USB cable, you don't have an issue. So it feels like a hub or USB cable issue there. Then we have, I used the USB cables that came with the range. Yeah, that's no guarantee. That is no guarantee at all. I for sure would try different USBs, but before you try different cables, your connection would be the most important thing to try. So if you are going into a hub, change that hub, or change the cable from the hub to the computer, work around it that way. Or see what happens if you just use 112 and the S11, if then it will still drop out sometimes or not. Or the other way around. So maybe you can bring it back to a single cable. But these kind of problems are hard to diagnose. And in my experience, in the end, it usually is either cable or hub that is the culprit. No hub is being used. But you have three USB leads with the 12s. Where are the leads going into? Are they going into the hub? The S11 doesn't have a hub. So you've got three USB hubs. Are those all three going into the computer? On the ones and twos, or what's happening to them? That is very important to know. Because as far as I can count, you need three leads. You have the S11 lead, and then you have the 212 leads. So you have three USB connections required. And as far as I know, the S11 didn't have a hub built in, but hey, we can double check that. Let's see if it's got a hub, why not? We are at it. Anyway, so let me zoom into that. There we are, from our friends at the back shop. Yeah, it has a CDJ controller connector that is USB. I think it is still the, because I'm not sure if it is, if those CDJ / controller connectors are 100% USB connectors, but if you change them, do you still have the same issue? And what happens if you use an external hub with it? But this feels like a hub issue to me. It has the feeling of a hub issue. So that I think that is where you should look into, my friend. Let's see, what else do we have on the menu today? All right, I told you it was kind of a Serato day, going to be a Serato day. One of the things that keeps popping up, a question that I keep getting repeatedly, is the following. Mixmaster G, I convert from Serato to Rekordbox, but why are my cue pads not maintained? I want my cue on the 1 pad and on the 3 pad, and if you do it, then everything goes the other way. So the question is, how and why is that the case? Let me explain that to you. So let's go back to the screen and let me show you why that is indeed the case. If we fire up our Serato, then if we load up, let's load up the track. You have the cues right here. Those are the cues, of course, as the Serato users know. And you've got the loops right here. You've got a total of 8 loops, but it will only go further if I add more loops. Now let's give a cue there. And let's give a cue. Now imagine that you like to have your cues like this, a cue there. And I put them randomly, folks, and a cue there. So I've got Q1, 2, and 3, and then I've got Q6. And I've got a loop, and that loop is at the beginning of the track. Now, if I go to Rekordbox, and let me open Rekordbox, you can see how annoying that little message is. Then you will immediately understand what the problem is here. There we are. And in Rekordbox, and especially if you are I'm in export mode now, but if you are in performance mode, because that makes things even bigger, and I load up a track, then we've got a total of 16 hot cues, named A through P, as you can see. Why is the track not loading? Well, no, it's not available. Okay, no problem. In normal use, you really have 8 hotkeys because most controllers only go from 1 to 8 and that's it. Then we also have the memory cues right there. And those are 10 in total. Now, memory cues don't have a pad assignment. You cannot set a cue at the 3rd memory cue. And I still need a track, so let me grab a track. So I can show you guys what I mean by that. So here we have a track. I can set a cue at the 5th pad, right like there. That's the cue at the 5th pad at the EQ. Now, if I want to set that same cue as a memory cue, right here, then I can't set it any place direct. The only thing I can say, memory, and then it will set that cue. Oh, hold on, I didn't cue it up. So I queued it up. And there it is. And that is that cue. I cannot put it at the 5th or at the 3rd, or it's always there. Then the second problem that we have is we have the hot cues and the memory cues. The hot cue bank and the memory cue bank, by the way, can contain both hot cues and it can contain loops. I can put a loop there. Now imagine if we go back to our Serato example right here, and I convert this information to record box. So we have 4 cues in total and we have a loop. And we want to maintain our exact pad position, it would become a mess. Because where do we leave the loop in that whole thing? Now, within the DJ Converse utility, you have the possibility to maintain hot cue pads. Loops are always stored at the next one. And you do that by the following. Let's double check that that's there. The Lady Gaga track we don't need. So let me quit that right here and let me show you how that all is done. Let's quit that too. Let's start up the DJ Converse utility and there it is. By the way, odds are that not everything is whitelisted because I am making tutorials and going for the final updates. And the version numbers you see on my screen are not the version numbers yet available in public. So that is all out of the way. But there are public betas for all of my apps. So if you have a license to any of my apps, I would really, really urge you to use the public betas. They are close to release and they bring some very nice features with it. We have to wait for this to finish. Always drag for it to find which record boxes are installed. And that is because my backup drive is still mounted, which is my own mistake. Let's see if I want to extend. You can eject it. No, you can eject it for sure. Go ahead. There we are. All right, you couldn't see it, but hey, it's ejected. All right, we go from Serato. Now, if I'm doing this the normal way, like this, with the recommended conversion method, and just start the conversion, let me show you what happens. Crate number one. That was the name of it. And while it is working, let's say hi to Robert Bogert. Peter, again, you saved the day. I am wrestling with Recordbox the past hour and turns out it was not using the right source library. That is a very famous one, Robert. You'll be amazed by how many times I fall for that shit that I think, all right, that's odd. It should all be there. It isn't there. And then in the end, I wasn't using the right library. I will show you guys what he means by that. There is a setting in Recordbox where you can tell it which library it needs to use if there are multiple libraries available. And if you set that wrong, then strange things can happen. Let me quickly show you that setting. It is not there, it is here. And then you go to view. I think it's in view. And then let's see. Oh, you need to be in export mode, I think. Or is it under advanced? Let me find. Why not? Let me find it. There it is. Database management. And there you can select which drive it should use if you have multiple available. And you always need to make sure that that is indeed the one that it needs to use. Otherwise, you will be very surprised. All right, let me show you guys what happened here. So here we have the track again. And you can see right here that I have the loop at the front because this is the loop that I use to play my track. So that is an eternal loop. And basically this is all sorted chronologically. And you can see that they are sorted chronologically. Everything is there and it makes sense because this one comes after the loop and that one comes there and that one comes there. And so they are sorted chronologically because otherwise it wouldn't make sense to put that loop anywhere. Now let me show you what you can do if you really, really, really want to maintain your hot cue pads. Again, I never understand why you would like that because I'm not a button pusher. I just need my hot cues to jump to. And if you really are, you really, really, really want to have them, then the best thing you can do is just give them a color or give them a name and a color, even better. But hey, if you really, really, really want to maintain the cue position, then you choose number 3. All cues to the hot bank and all loops to the memory bank, which takes away that problem that we otherwise have where the loop doesn't make sense in positioning, in placing. So that's one. And then the other thing is take off the smart placement in the hot bank. What that means, that smart placement means is smart placements divide the track in 8 segments and then will put the loop in the segment that makes the most sense. Basically comes down to a start cue will be at the beginning of the track in 1 or 2, in pad 1 or 2, and an end cue will be at the 8th or 7th pad. And you have room in between to set extra cues. If you, like me, come from Traktor and you sometimes set cue points and you want, for instance, do wordplay. And if you do wordplay, you need some room between the cues because words are usually on very odd positions in the track. Then you are very happy that you have room. So that's the reason why that is done, that you can make the maximum use of all the 8 hot cue positions that are available. But let me show you guys how this works out if we convert like this. And then we have to wait for it again. And there we go. And in the meantime, guys, if you have questions for me, put them in the chat. I'm happy to address them whenever I have the time for it, and if I can answer them. Now again, here are my cues. And this time you can see that indeed we have the hot cues exactly identical to how they were in Serato. And if you go to the memory bank, we only have the loop there. So it is possible to maintain the cues if you really, really want. Then there was a question that came in through YouTube that is also related to Serato conversion. This is a Record Box user who has very detailed loops and cues in 2000 tracks which are in Record Box, and he asks me if I go to Serato, will those also be placed exactly the way they are in Record Box? In general, yes, they will be. Why do I say in general? There is a thing named the MP3 encoder shift. And the MP3 encoder shift can make cues and loops shift a tiny little bit depending on the MP3 encoder that was used and the source and target DJ software you use. There is a long explanation in my YouTube channel why this happens. The DJ conversion utility has a built-in compensation that compensates for most known encoders. And the good thing is I can update that. I can update that matrix. So if you have an encoder that the DJ conversion utility does not know about, and as a result you get shifting cues and loops, then you can tell me about it, send a log file. In the log file, it will tell you which encoder was found, and I can maybe compensate for that. It is this little option, compensate for MP3 cue and loop shifts, and you basically always want to have that on, but it makes the conversion a little bit slower because the DJ conversion utility needs to analyze each and every track if it is an MP3 track to see if it has an encoder shift. But in general, OIS, I can tell you that indeed your cues and loops will be placed exactly the way you want them to be. Now, another thing that also pops up each and every time with the conversion to Serato is that the grids are not converted or not converted correctly. Problem with that is that grids are converted from Rekordbox to Serato. The grid will be converted. However, Serato has the mandatory analysis of tracks that each DDA software has, and that creates the graphical representation of the track and stuff like that. The problem with the Serato mandatory analysis is that it will always analyze for key and for BPM slash grid, which means if you convert tracks to Serato that are not yet analyzed and you load a track in the Serato deck, Serato will analyze that track and as a result override the converted BPM values with its analysis data. To overcome that, the best thing you can do is just analyze all the tracks in the conversion and then run the conversion again. So you convert from Rekordbox to Serato, you analyze all the tracks that you converted, you will see that the cues and loops are perfectly there. However, the grids might be off because of Serato's analysis. Run the conversion again and then the converted values will stick. So just a little tip, because a lot of people are asking me about that. Then I had a very, very, very strange experience with Engine DJ. I cannot mimic it. I try to reproduce it, but I had this Engine DJ user who was using the Engine Prime cleaner, which is my tool to relocate audio files that are read in Engine DJ and stuff like that. And the problem was, whatever he did, if he loaded the track in the deck like this, it did not show. There was nothing here, nothing showed up. So we did this and then it didn't show exactly like you see right here. And we were checking if the track was there. So if he set the show in Finder, it will show the track. We were trying to drag it straight into the deck. It didn't load. No matter what we did, a track didn't load. And not one track, no, all tracks. Nothing worked. Turned out that if you are in Engine DJ, in the preferences, in the audio device, and the selected audio device is not available, then Engine DJ will not do it. Again, I could not replicate this on my deck, but I wanted to point that out. If you are on Engine DJ and you cannot load a single track and you are certain that you did add Engine DJ to the full disk access system preferences, which are these. So you go to the system preferences, to security and privacy, and then to full disk access, and then Engine DJ should be in this list. If it is there and it's still not loading, then just switch your USB or your audio device in the preferences under audio device, and most likely it will come back. Just a little tip. It took me 3/4 of an hour to figure that one out. So I hope I can save some people some time with this. Then another thing that keeps popping up is the iTunes / music preferences how I like to use them. Especially the Serato users amongst us like to use iTunes and have these options on. So keep the iTunes media folder organized and copy the files. They have that both on because for Serato it doesn't matter, but the moment they go to Rekordbox, there will be a huge problem if you do that. So my tools all recommend you to switch that off. And the same, by the way, in the music app, you have those very same settings there and you can switch them off. Now, one thing that a lot of people don't understand is this. If you use that option, so let me mimic that. Let me fire up iTunes. And let me switch them on in the I am on that Mojave machine, which is why my Mac looks like this. Let me make a duplicate of this because I'm not going to do with a real track. And then let's create a playlist there. And let's move those tracks into that playlist. And then they should be moved up. Let's see, reveal show in Finder. Indeed, they are moved from this folder to its own folder. Now, if you switch that off, if you say, all right, Mixmaster G, I understand why I cannot use that. The reason for that is file path. And again, there is a tutorial about this in my YouTube channel, why this is so important. But you can safely switch this off. And if you switch this off, nothing will happen to your tracks. Everything will be fine. Nothing will happen to your tracks. They will still be in that very complex storage structure. However, they are now static and no longer dynamic. Why not? I will show you guys what I mean by that, because this is so important to understand View as a list of songs, please. So let me show that. Let me switch it on again. And let me show you guys why this is so important. So we have Kenny Stetton here, Nights on Broadway. And let's say we change the artist to Stetton Candy. Like this. Now let's find out where that track is stored. That is stored, if I ask it on it, you see iTunes Media, Music, Stetton Candy, Zwarte Lijst 2016. Now, if I change this back to the way it were, let me make things visible. That always helps, right? So let's do that. Let's get a little teach text document like this. So this is at the moment the file path of that particular track. And especially this part, this segment of it, is very important. This is how Recordbox recognizes that track. This is how Engine DJ recognizes that track. This is how basically almost all DJ software recognizes that track. Now, the moment, let me take it to the complete level, just for the sake of simplicity, that you understand why this is so important, because we can go back and forth about it and can tell you about it, but seeing is believing, right? So we go to the playlist and we go to test. Why is that not updated? That is not updated because, let's go to the export mode. This is one of the famous bugs in Recordbox, by the way. I'm not sure if it is using the XML. There it is. Here we have the track. Let me load it up and let me give it a cue. Right? So that's all fine. I quit Recordbox. We are back in iTunes and let's edit this one and let's make the artist the way it should be, Candy Stetton. Now, first let me show you what happens to that file path, because if you put it under it, you can see that what used to be Stetton, Candy is now become Candy Stetton, which is an entirely different file path. It might as well have been Chinese as far as my computer is concerned, because this file path is nothing close to the other file path. Now, if I go to Recordbox and I load up that Candy Stetton track, I can already tell you that what will happen is it will load, but we lose our cues and loops because we changed the file path. Let me reload that. There we are. You see, it loads, but the cues are lost because it is on a different file path and it needs to be reanalyzed and stuff like that. This is just a simple example, but trust me, this can wreak havoc in your collection. And that is the reason why I always recommend turn it off. Now, the moment you turn it off, like this, and let's go back to Recordbox. So I have turned it off. Let's go back to Recordbox. And we load in that particular track again, and it didn't have a cue, but we are going to give it a cue. Come on. So we're going to give it a different cue than that was. Let's put a cue on the E. So we did give it a cue. Let me quit it. Let me edit the name of it again. I know this is boring as hell, but hey, you need to understand this stuff. Like this. And if I ask in the Finder where it's located and we drag it. Then you see that this file path and that file path are still the same, even if I did edit the tag. Why? Because I gave it the correct preferences. Now, and if I go to record box, you will see that it loads the cues and loops. So, because the file path was not changed by iTunes. And that is why this is so very important. I cannot press it enough, folks. This is really the number one problem that DJs in general have with iTunes, that they have that option off because it looks so simple. Well, in truth, it is just a nightmare. If you use this option because it will copy your tracks from the downloads folder where you buy your tracks and download them to the folder you want them in for storage, I have a tool for that that will do it all automatically. That tool is named the iTunes Collection Tool, ICT for short, right here. And in the ICT, you have the option to tell Listen ICT, I want this folder with downloaded tracks to be part of that playlist, and then ICT will know, all right, and then you want to store it on that particular folder. So if you go to add new tracks, you see you can say here, where are those folders or where are those audio tracks? Then you can select the playlist that you want to set it to, like this. And then you can say, all right, move the source audio files to this folder. That folder and that playlist are like a team. They are like a pair together. So it will be remembered. And one of the unique things that the ICT also does is it will check if their audio file is not already in your iTunes collection, and it uses all your fingerprinting for that. So it does a lot of stuff, and please, please, please use that. Don't use iTunes to store or to manage the storage of your audio files, because you will get into trouble sooner rather than later with that. So that was that. Let me find my, I closed my list of things that I wanted to talk about. So that was about switching off the copy files option in iTunes or in its successor, the music app. Then there is a thing that the iTunes collection tool can do that is not very well known. And for that, I'm going to turn on Quicksilver. Quicksilver is a little app that allows you to keyboard trigger certain shortcuts. So if you have a script or a thing or an app or something, that then you can launch it with Quicksilver. Now, if I go back to iTunes, let me remove the songs. Let me remove some of the stuff like this. And let me add a test track there. Let's take the brand new Heavies, Midnight at the Oasis. So this track right now, View as Song. Oh, it has some things there. It has, all right, let's take away the genre and let's take away the artwork, because I want it to have different artwork. Now, my source for finding tags for of audio files is always Discogs. There are auto-tagging apps out there, but I don't trust them, and I don't trust them with my collection at all. So if you go to Discogs, then I can try to find that track on Discogs, but that of course is a lot of work. For that I designed a shortcut that is F3. If I press F3, you heard that little cling. The artist and title are in the clipboard of the Mac. So if I say paste right here, it will, you see it? There it is. And I can say, all right, I want to go to, for instance, this version of it. There we are. And now I have the F4 key. And if I press that F4 key, let me copy this one something wonderful will happen if iTunes is at the forefront like this, because it's not taking it, but it should take the information from Discogs and then paste it on the, and that's weird, and then paste it on that particular track. So that saves you usually a lot of information or overtyping. Oh, there it goes. Copy it. I have no idea why it's not copying the information. Ah, it did. You see, there is the artwork. And I don't know if the year, let me get the year there, but it did its work, but it didn't show it. 1994, but if we take that away, let me edit that as well. I know this is always a bit. Not taking it over. Should take it over, but hey. I don't know, but trust me, it usually works pretty well and saves you a lot of typing. And that's the whole thing about it. That also brings me to the end of the stream, which means I'm going to close the stream down in a moment, unless there is somebody with a question, which I'm then happy to answer. So you can drop that in the chat. If not, then we are going to close out the chat for today. Like I said, keep an eye open on Twitch to see who is live streaming from the DJ Expo in Atlantic City show floor. That will give you a little bit of an impression of what is going on there, and that might be nice. So keep an eye on that. I will be back, I hope, next week. If you've got questions in the meantime and you are watching this on demand, you can always ask your questions in the comments below this video. If you like what I'm doing, then don't forget to tell your DJ friends that I'm doing this stuff, that you can get information from the horse's mouth if you like. Ask me. And of course, don't forget to like, subscribe, share, and all that other good stuff. For now, thank you all for watching. I hope to see you all guys all next week. Mixmaster G is going to sign off.